I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The grace, kindness, and love of God be with you. A warm welcome to St. Stephen's Church this afternoon. To those of you here present and those who are joining us at home. I'm Debbie Pan, I'm Associate Priest here at St. Stephen's Church, where Philip had close associations and often worshipped for many years. We gather to be present with Philip for the last time. Philip liked the music of the Abbey as well as St. Stephen's, and he would often worship there. So I only met Philip on occasions when he came and joined Kate. And as I realised, as I spoke with Claire and Helly to plan the service, I realised that although I'd met Philip, I didn't know him terribly well. And I'm sad that I didn't know him better. Philip had struggled with his health for some time, and that took a turn for the worst in January this year. Having returned home for what was thought to be his last few weeks, sadly he died sooner than was expected. So we're grateful that he was able to have his last days at home. He's been released from his suffering, but he's been torn from you far too soon, and that's hard and sad. So as we gather together, we hold both our gratitude for life shared with him and our sadness. Together we'll give thanks for him, we'll remember your time with him, we'll commend him to God, trusting that God receives him with love and kindness, and will support one another in our sadness. So do take a seat as we come to our opening prayer. Loving God, our refuge and our strength, you are a very present help in times of sorrow. With you we have nothing to fear, and in your hope we place our trust in the mystery of life and death before us. So speak to us now your words of eternal life. For though we're parted from fear, we cannot be separated from your love, the light and the peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. One of the things, as I talked with Helly and Claire, that became quite apparent was Philip's love for music. We're going to begin with a hymn which sadly we can't sing, but which was significant. It was a hymn, or angel voices ever singing, that the Seeley family would listen to on their way to church. It was an hour-long drive to church when they were living in Jakarta each Sunday, and they would be listening to this. So we're going to listen to the... it's in the order of service. We're going to listen now to Angel Voices Ever Singing.
Thank you.
voices of the choir from Norwich Cathedral. Kate has recorded a tribute to Philip, which we are going to hear now.
My darling Phil, what a love story we have enjoyed together, starting with our interview in Unilever in 1973, when we both retrospectively agreed that we fell in love there and then. Then several months later, you asked me to marry you on our first proper date. We enjoyed a wonderful marriage together, and you were such a marvellous daddy to our two daughters, and later a precious grandpa to our three grandchildren. I will try to capture a few highlights to share with our family and friends today. Phil was born in Meriden, Warwickshire, on the 17th of April 1950 to Ivy and Dennis Seeley. 4 years later, his sister Brenda arrived and they grew up together in Birmingham. Apparently, Phil was always a prankster within the family. His mother actually advised me not to marry him because she thought he would cause me grief and that I could do better. Phil attended grammar school in Birmingham, where he apparently devoted much of his time to rugby, cricket and basketball, sometimes to the detriment of academic studies. However, he went on to Leeds University to read business, again spending a lot of time playing rugby and bridge. Most of Phil's career was spent working for Unilever in various senior marketing roles, including in the UK, Singapore, Indonesia, Dubai, and Egypt. The family went too, and was so privileged to experience so many cultures as well as the expatriate lifestyle. Phil was very well respected for his strong intellect on marketing and business strategy, and this is reflected in the several letters and tributes received following his death. His teens clearly enjoyed working with him and have stories to recount of this. When Phil and Kate married in September 1976, Phil said in his wedding speech, "I simply went for interview with Unilever to get a job, and I ended up with a wife as well." Phil was very keen to have a family quite quickly, and was delighted when first Claire arrived, and then 16 months later, Helen was born. He always said, "Two beautiful daughters to look after me in my old age." He excelled as their daddy, being so loving and caring while they were younger. He took them swimming every week, enjoyed fun days out with them, bike rides, and even horse riding. In parallel, he encouraged their love of music and family games, including bridge. As the girls grew up, he was always a good and wise counsel to them, so proud of their achievements and supportive of them and attending their musical performances. Mealtimes were special and were always full of animated chat on marketing, business, politics, and life in general. In addition to being a daddy, Phil also greatly enjoyed the company of special family friends and their children. These included Caroline and Jim and their sons Matthew and William, Karen and John and their sons Jonathan and David, Richard and the late Crystal and their children Lucy and Giles, Richard and the late Anne and their daughters Caroline and Georgina, and also Nick and Cheryl. Phil was thrilled to be grandpa to Oscar, Felix and Deathly, and they all adored him, even though grandpa's word was always final. Driving away from hospital when Oscar was born, Phil quite emotionally said, We have such responsibility for this little boy. And he, of course, felt just the same when Felix and Effie subsequently came along. He played rugby, football, and cricket with the boys and taught them bridge, chess, piano, and many card games. Effie loved exploring her grandpa's study and rearranging all his artifacts. The grandchildren already have their eyes on the special items that they hold most precious from Phil's study. Phil had a deep interest in classical music, especially opera, throughout his life. He also loved politics, current affairs, rugby, and red wine. A side of Phil that many might not know is his involvement in church affairs. He was on the parochial church council at St. Stephen's Church and treasurer between 1985 and 1987. On a Sunday evening, he used to lock up the church after evensong and wend his way up to the rich McDonald's to cash in all the coins for notes and have a pint, of course. He also helped with Julia Church services in Dubai and Bath, and even led the Christmas morning family service in Bath when a former vicar, Ralph, was taken ill. He also greatly enjoyed and valued the music of the Abbey Church in Bath in former years. Phil embodied so many wonderful qualities. He was a true gentleman, always impeccably dressed, and he had a huge sense of integrity. He was always kind, a wonderful host and raconteur, and was so humble about his achievements. Phil was a wonderfully supportive husband to me, always encouraging me in my various endeavours. He said to me every morning when I was dressed, "You look lovely. What better start to each day could I possibly have had?" In later life, Phil did not enjoy great health, suffering two strokes and then finally an intestinal disease. We did not expect to lose him so soon, and all missed him so dearly. However, his death was very peaceful, and he died at home, for which we will be eternally grateful. Rest in peace, our darling Phil.
Such a lovely tribute, thank you, Kate. Music, as Kate has said, was a big feature in the Seeley household, and Claire and Helly often performed John Rutter's For the Beauty of the Earth at their local churches, a church in Cairo in the 1990s. They've recorded themselves recently singing this, accompanied by Nick Thorne, the organist at our sister church.
Thank you.
What father wouldn't be proud of his daughters singing so beautifully? No wonder they were asked to speak to sing so many times in the time of Cairo. Family was hugely important, as Kate has mentioned to Philip. And the wonderful grandchildren, Oscar, Felix and Effie, are going to read a recording of them reading a poem, Inside Our Dreams, by Jean Willis.
Where do people go when they die?
Somewhere down below or in the sky.
I can't be sure, said Grandpa, but it seems they simply set up home inside our dreams.
Beautiful. Well done, all of you. We're going to hear a second hymn now, a hymn that was sung at Philip and Kate's wedding back in September 1976 at St Mark's Church, Surbiton. Love Divine, or Love's Excelling.
Verses 4 to 7 are important because they occur in a beautiful setting by Henry Purcell. Phil was a great lover of music, but most importantly, a discriminating lover of music. And he would have adored, as we all do, this wonderful setting by Henry Purcell. But crucially, it's the last verse that really matters, because here you have all the qualities that St. Paul wants the community of Philippians to have, which I think all of us here believe Phil had in spades. And as I use that bridge metaphor, I realised that the last time that I spent time with Phil together was when he and I partnered against Claire and Penny in Bridge. I could not have played worse. The defeat could not have been more spectacular, and Phil could not have been more gracious in defeat. I'm sorry. So, from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help these women which laboured with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow labourers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things.
Thank you, Joan, and for that lovely introduction and putting that passage so beautifully into context. I said at the beginning that although I had met Philip on many an occasion, since the 5 years or so that I've been here, I didn't know him as well as I would have liked. He struck me, though, as a true gentleman. Someone who was quiet, perhaps, capable, thoughtful. As Kate said, always immaculately dressed. Definitely a suit for church sort of person. But never in a fussy way, just beautifully understated and tidy. So it was wonderful to learn from that when I spoke to with Claire and with Helly, that there was so much more to Philip than I had seen in the church services here. They spoke of that livelier side of him, his wonderful sense of humour, wicked, I think it was described as, obviously a lovely practical joker at times, and that sense of him being the life and soul of the party. And how that's been so true, especially in his younger years, and perhaps not so much latterly, certainly the Philip that I saw when he was here in church. It wouldn't have been appropriate for starters. They also spoke wonderfully of his inquiring mind. And not only was he a voracious reader, but the way that he retained that knowledge, but with a humility. The way that he sought to understand others and other people's lives and cultures. The way that they spoke of his ability to make friends, especially when living abroad, even though he didn't always speak much of the language, how he would manage to befriend the local shopkeepers and the locals. He obviously had a great empathy for others that shone through. They also recounted that time of the homeless person, his care for the homeless person that he'd encountered when closing St. Stephen's Church on that winter's night that Kate remembered. Those acts of kindnesses ran deep. They also talked about the way that he'd read the books that they were reading for their exams. And that obviously had a big impact on him, not in the way that he was these days we might think that a parent might be pushy by reading their children's books, exam books, but the way that he just wanted to share life with them. The way that they could then talk about those books around the dinner table. And so that real sense of him journeying with them. It worked both ways, him sharing their knowledge and inspiring them, but also he shared his knowledge, his love of bridge and chess and music and rugby. He was deeply devoted to his family and to friends, as we've heard. In fact, as we were talking, we had a lovely time with Claire and Helly reminiscing about so much of the great gifts that Phillip had. And I found myself in the end saying, was there anything that he couldn't do? To which they replied, his handwriting needed a little to be desired. What emerged from our discussions, from what I know of what I've met in Phillip, was the way that his faith underpinned his life. The way that there was Paul's words, his words of advice, to take everything in your stride, trusting that God is with you, and to focus on those things that are pure and lovely and noble and admirable. Those things were so evident in Philip. But Paul didn't write those words as a moral code to live by, but as an example of a life of faith lived in Jesus. Paul always in his writings points to Jesus, to his different perspective, to God's perspective, to the hope that Jesus brings. And they were very much part of what Philip was and is. And I say is because Jesus' resurrection gives us hope that life lives on after death. Of course, we can't be sure for certain what happens when we die. Just as we don't know for certain what lies beyond the hills that surround our lovely city. But we know that what's on one side of the hills gives us an indication of what is on the other. Jesus died and lived and died to show God's love for us. Take that same looking at the love in this life and the life that we have in looking at what goes on after this life. And love is that essence of life. It's love which forms us. It's love which nourishes us. It's love that allows us to grow as individuals, as families, as communities. And yet, to love also makes us vulnerable. Vulnerable that what we have is what one day we might lose. But who wouldn't love? And the beauty of love is that even in times of loss, love never dies. Carries on in our hearts and our memories. That will never change. Philip's love for you doesn't end with his death, just as your love for him doesn't end now either. And he lives on in you, in the ways that you shared your journeys together, the way that your journeys together formed you, his views, his thoughts, his opinions, his love, they all formed you as you helped to form him. That lives on too. Some of you may know I live in a farmhouse, and we have one of the facets of one wall faces south in this lovely old stone farmhouse. And on a a summer's day and you've had a lovely warm day. When at the end of the day, when the sun has gone down and the chill of the evening has fallen, if you walk past that wall, it still gives out its warmth. It's a place where you want to stay. It's comforting and it's warm. And so it is with the love that you shared with Philip that carries on. So our Christian hope is that wrapped up in that love and life, that life endures too. That this isn't the end, but a beginning. And our prayer now is that Philip is truly at home, in all the love of heaven, waiting to see us again. Philip's family have chosen two pieces of reflective music to play now. During this first piece, a Lacrimosa, there'll be a selection of wonderful treasured photographs and memories of Philip's life that we show on the screen, and which we will endeavour to show on those of you watching at home. It may be a little bit faint, and apologies for that, but we hope you can see some of the lovely scenes from his life. And the next, the following piece, as that is played, the Pieiesi, family and friends here are invited to lay a red rose on Philip's coffin. And for those of you watching at home, you are invited to light a candle in Philip's memory at that time too. So first we'll listen to Lacrimosa.
I am not there.
to come to our time of prayers. Just invite you to hold a picture of Phillip in your mind, the best he was for you. To the words, Lord, in your mercy, please respond to hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Philip, for all that was good in his life, for his generosity and depth of caring, his kindness and sense of humour, his inquisitive mind and retentive memory, for his practical abilities in the garden and around the home, for his love of bridge, rugby and music, and for his dedication to his family, for his loyalty and friendship, for all that made him Philip. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, grant that we may learn from Philip's life, that we may live with courage and generosity, with honesty and integrity, with faith and celebration of all that life gives, so we might grow to be the people you want us to be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy on all who mourn, those gathered here and those unable to be present. Remember especially Kate, Claire, Richard, Helen and Jeremy, Oscar, Felix, and Effie, and Brenda, and all Philip's family. Grant them peace. We pray for his friends, and all whose lives were richer for him. Grant them peace. Give them patient faith as they adjust to life without Philip, especially in the loneliest of times. Strengthen them with your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal any memories of hurt and failure and regret. Give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in a way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you know the secrets of our hearts. You hold that which is hard to hold within. You bear our pain, you bear our anger, you bear our tears and our loneliness. You bear the questions that have no answers. Comfort us in our grief, and come close even if we do not call you by name, and in the darkest places, give us hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So we gather our prayers together, praying together the words that our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The last part of our service will be largely unannounced. If you'd like to make a donation in Phillip's memory, these will be gratefully received and will benefit the musicians benevolent fund, reflecting Phillip's lifelong passion for music. Following the commendation, the Ecclesian choir, which includes Helen and conducted by Jeremy, will sing the blessing in an arrangement by Helly's good friend, Phillip Stopford. And as Phillip is taken from the church, a recording of Do Not Be Afraid by Phillip Stopford will be played, and it's a live recording made at Effie's christening. But before that, we have our final hymn, The Day Thou Gavest, which was recorded by Helly and Jeremy in January this year, just before Phillip became ill. Please stand, if you're able, for the commendation. Phillip, go forth from this world in the love of God who created you, in the mercy of Jesus Christ who redeemed you, in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthened you. May angels sustain you, the saints welcome you, and all the company of heaven enfold you, in communion with all the faithful. May you dwell this day in peace. Amen. Amen. Do say for the blessing. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and always.